over the next 5 years, we will look at 6 states. That is a kind of ambition. So to kind of get a sense of what is the housing context across the country. So that is one. Sri Parambur, Chennai, if you look at the outskirts of Chennai, you know, big industries have come up, the village houses are getting converted into PG accommodations. Gurgaon is really not, the call center employees are not really living in those big gated communities, but they are living in the villages which are kind of transforming into chawl-like apartments. Bombay created call centers, did not succeed, was not very successful, did not multiply, did not grow, particularly because there is no housing which is complementing to call centers. So there is a whole range of things that are happening across various cities which are defining the housing context. So that is one. The second thing I want to say is that the idea of house is also not the same everywhere. For example, I mean, we looked at, one of the things is the pavement dwellers. You know, pavement dwellers were usually construction labor who are not the already settled pavement dwellers, but also the moving mobile pavement dwellers. And they come temporarily in various places, and then we decided to follow one such group, and while following one such group, we reached the village of Murbad, because that is what happens. 3 months, 4 months they are in the city, and 7 months, 8 months they are in their village, which is a tribal village. The house over there is very interesting. It's a shack really. But the house is not that shack, but the house is also the landscape in front, the house is the river behind, the forest ahead. It has no boundaries, and it changes every year. Every year the community comes together, builds a new house. So there is no idea of modern kind of houses. And this is true even for urban housing. For example, if you look at the chawls of Mumbai between 1880s to all the way 1920s, 1930s also, 1940s also, and even subsequently after they were made, they produced a certain kind of life, because you cannot say this is one particular house, because the entire chawl becomes one house, you know, because it's one large house which kind of folds into some rooms during the night. So the idea of house is also kind of varied and diverse. And just to kind of, you know, reinstate what Professor Peter has been saying, they're kind of, you know, highly segmented. The third thing also comes from an experience. I was involved with the housing policy development for Karnataka state, and the figures and the numbers were very, very close to that of Mumbai. You know, Karnataka entire urban housing situation as compared to Mumbai as one city. What were the numbers? The numbers were this. Roughly around 15 lakh was identified. 1.5 million houses housing shortage was identified. The state built in the last 15 years 1.5 lakhs, which is 150,000, which is 1/10 of it. And last 10 years have been the best of the regimes in terms of housing policy as well as for finance. So, for the public sector to build, you know, to build 1.5 million would take another 100 years, you know, in the current capacity. The condition of those houses, if we revisit, they are similar to what Rashini was showing in Bombay. Very close over here, there are several of these examples. You know, the condition of these appear to be quite pathetic. They are not housing actually. So that is as far as the state kind of, you know. The private sector, on the other hand, there is the famous monitor report which kind of says the private sector really doesn't build smart something on affordable housing. It's like, it's out of question. Which is because the affordable, which is kind of, you know, three times of annual income or five times, six times, it doesn't feature anywhere. You know, the affordability that we pitched in Karnataka was 7 lakhs. You know, the house for 7 lakh rupees, and that was not produced by any developer across the state. So private developer is not kind of, you know, producing houses for the. So this is the three contexts. That the context for housing across the country is different. It's not really around affordability, it's about larger organization questions. the idea of house is not same, it is different, for every context, every people, even within the city. And the state and the private sector really cannot kind of, you know, do this mass production of houses. Except for Andhra, which is in the 80s under N.T. Rama Rao, there is no real big example of, you know, big production of houses. And N.T. Rama Rao also, you know, under specific conditions. So that is a kind of, you know, background and framing. My main points are that if you look at public good, I mean beyond rivalry, you know, rivalry, disputability questions, if you look at them to be kind of created by the state, then they are accompanied with the idea of standard good also. The idea of standard good. Public good is required to be standard delivery, standard version. And there is where the problem lies. That it can get reduced to a standard good. The rights question, you know. You reduce it to a standard good and the emerging conditions of urbanity as well as what we see historically, housing and house is not a standard good, nor it is kind of, you know, it's varied and diverse. This particular standardization may not be appropriate for the kind of diversity and heterogeneity that exists in the lives and entrepreneurships and various aspects through which the city is built. So rather than focusing on housing very specifically, and this is for the states and the local governments, look at the broader urbanization policy which we do not have. We do not have an urbanizing policy. We do not have an urbanization policy. For example, we were focusing on, I mean, one thing that we said in the Karnataka housing policy is that, you know, the state cannot fill, even if it triples its capacity, it will require another 50 years. State can't. But it is not that the people are living do not have houses. It has to do with current housing and improving current housing, working out an expansion possibility, improvement possibility, upgradation possibility, retrofitting, repair possibility. What we found, and then the government came back and said, you know, well, okay, then develop a policy, you know, for doing this retrofitting and repair. And then we looked at, you know, across architecture schools and engineering schools. We do not teach retrofitting at all. We do not teach. There is nothing. There are no standards. There are no manuals. There is no ecology for the state to kind of set up this. So I think if you look at a broader urbanization kind of with a broader urbanization orientation, then we can fold in many levels of intervention, you know, which may have multiple entry points. On the other hand, in all the cities that I've spoken about, Mangalore, Mysore, Sri Perambudur, Kota, Vijayawada, we've seen that the private sector has already started. You know, there are hostels, there are paying guest accommodations, there are chawl-like things which are emerging, there are specifically women occupancy housing which are developed in Gurgaon, for example. There's a whole range of things that are being emerging, which are responsive, which are kind of, you know, and if we kind of fold in these emerging facts into the housing question, then I think we'll get a fairly nuanced and far more precise understanding and intervention ideas. I think I just
The all is for those who don't have a house. Given that we all know that people have family homes, how is that ever going to work? So if someone has, you mentioned migration, but I'm thinking just in terms of the fact that you have, you know, joint family homes. So does that count or doesn't it count? So if you have a family home, does that, is that then considered?
So procedurally, they have made it so simple because, see, if it's a public allocated scheme, they would create all kinds of difficulties. If just now this is a self-affidavit saying this is my income, I don't have a house anywhere in the country, here I am. Okay. The lender lends, assesses the repayment capacity, and that's how affordable housing
okay,
is.
Okay, so it's so no one checks.
No one checks
about
the
house. And anyway, it's totally irrelevant if you've got a house somewhere in the northeast which belongs to the grandparents with five siblings in it.
There are more nuances. Like, so many of the resettlement colonies wide off in the peripheries.
Mm.
In cities like Delhi, one sees that during the weekdays, people are called homeless because they are sleeping in their cars and their taxis and whatever.
Mm.
But they have homes in the periphery.
Mm.
No, but that can be easily rectified by modifying that particular rule, as we have for the IAS officers and others, that you cannot have more than one house allotted by the government under the personal scheme in the same district.
Yeah.
That can be misused. So you'll have to work that out a little bit. And the self-affidavit thing, like the Bangalore property tax experiment, if it is put on the website, then no one checks is fine. But the point is that if I know that you have a house and you have declared it and it's on the website, then you will be penalized very severely.
But I'm thinking in a different way. I'm thinking that anyway, if it were to be checked, then it creates a host of other problems, because with these village homes or family homes or peripheral homes, it makes no sense to deny someone access to a house if they happen to have a house somewhere else, which might be inhabited by parents, siblings, it might be very far away, it might be a rural home. That's what I had misunderstood.
Yeah.
It
is a problem conceptually.
Yeah.
But
yes,
operationally, they have...
If it becomes a rule, then it will become a huge problem.
Thank
you. Amazingly complimentary presentation. I've been looking at PPPs and we've seen all the bad things that happen with PPPs, but you reminded us that actually public sector has been equally problematic for serving the poorest. So I was beginning to despair of what the solution was until Prasad came in with sort of work with what we've got. And
you can't do much.
So,
10 years of 10 years of working with the government, and so it's kind of there is a nudging possibility. There is a nudging possibility, particularly in the housing sector, that you can do a good regulatory basis. You can kind of put a good marketing system. But these are the things that can happen. But until you have an organization understanding of what is happening across, in a larger framework, which the states do not have currently, these will be kind of, they are susceptible for either 25% being empty or something, or them being the way they are, or them being completely irrelevant. For example, people remove from one place and place in another location, which is completely which kind of disrupts all ties.
But that will tick a box with someone being housed, because they'll be taken from some housing to be put in a house. That kind of relocation, is that what you mean?
Yeah.
That will meet policy requirements, but causes all sorts of other mess. So it seems quite sort of rigid rules sort of imposed policy-wise, which ignore the sort of the flexibilities, the wider circumstances that you referred to.
For example, I'll tell you, in 1991, there was something called the Hinamandani complex which came up in the city of Bombay, which is basically on the ULC land. you know, the land was acquired by the government to produce houses for the poor, for affordable housing, and then what came up in that location was luxury apartments, very large, you know, luxury apartments. But what it did was it set the tone for the luxury apartments in the next decade. You know, the housing scenarios can completely change, and luxury apartments start coming. So till now you have 2-bedroom, 3-bedroom, 4-bedroom apartments, you know, now even gated communities are kind of, you know, advertised. What is happening now, in the last 6 months, 3 developers have committed suicide in the city of Bombay. There is a complete lie. Last 5 years there has been no increase in the property prices as far as real estate, housing, residential real estate concerned. Commercial real estate has come down. It's for the first time you have developers kind of, you know, advertising for clearly writing the price of the house on a holding in this city. Before you'd never had, 3 years ago, you never had any developer kind of, you have developers offering EMI possibility, you know, they're becoming bankers almost. And then now you find these micro apartments emerging in this city, you know. And this is not coming either from public policy or from, you know, this is coming as a response to what is happening to the overall economy of the city, actually. So I think there is a change that is one is already seeing, because the backbone of this developer is also not sturdy. You know, it's also kind of, you know, because the economy is changing. It is not only felt only in the case of Mumbai. In many cities you see this. So I think that there is, the state needs to have an understanding of what is happening to the, what you call the city, as well as the urbanization trends, actually. And from there, rather than going, you know.
You know, the point of despair is about the role of the state. And in last 3 years, they have changed up all the policy regime from demonetization onwards. The entire backbone of even the real estate economy has been broken today. And so there's no stability of any policy regime, and you don't know an overnight sort of, I mean, are we becoming banana republic or what? It's, we are now asking our question. And so it's in this, because if there is a role of state as a provider or a welfare distributing mechanism, the state has failed, because the character of Indian state needs to be looked into now as to what it is. That we have an Indian constitution, it's a very well-written constitution with very embedded welfare norms and rights-based, etc. But in function, in its practice, we see, and so all this is because of the political economy that we have, and that's around the land. It's in a true sense of pre-capitalist wealth accumulation system for land. And actors of the state are very much entrenched in this regime. And so,
in what way?
In the regime of appropriating wealth from the land.
Right.
And their nexus across various other actors who are in the, I don't know what is underground economy, the overground economy today, but whatever it is. So and that really leads to failure of whatever we are doing in terms of policy. There was a glimmer of hope for 2 years, where large number of stakeholders were brought together under the previous regime in what was called Rajiv Awas Yojana, and the shabby reason to sort of throw that program out was the name was partisan, and Rajiv belonging to Congress party, but now the new regime, you can give a new name, we have no dispute with names, but it was well discussed, well sort of, it is large number of stakeholders were sort of party to its formulation. There were deviations in its implementation at the local level, but because the program was well framed, one could pull up the local governments for those kind of deviations, but it just met
it's dead in 2 years' time. It was framed in 11-12 and 2014 it was gone. And any such thing that has more possibilities of distribution just gets scuttled somehow. And so that is where we are in the housing sector today. So the PPP debate on whether it's private or public, I think it's to be sort of contextualized in this political economy than in the cities. And bigger the city, but that regime, as Prasad is saying, is also playing, and the main actors in that are actually also committing suicides. And
that's the
so even private, I mean, in Ahmedabad also, in number of new local regulations as well as national regulations has led to stifling of the private sector in the real estate as well. And the small developers, builders are completely wiped out. They've gone away for the last 10, 15 years, but now even the bigger are feeling the hit. And so in this, you need to not just look at what is housing, but for example, in Ahmedabad, we have this town planning mechanism for, say, land, public, whatever it is, to get it land pooling and readjustment as a planning mechanism, in which a new regulation has been, and it is a process, it has three-stage process to understand it, it requires, but a new legislation, a new amendment to it has been introduced in 2017, which will not allow greenfield amalgamation of lands. So now the developers are left in the lurch as to what will they do, because the brownfield ones are small parcels. And they have to negotiate with large number of land owners, with so much of property disputes among the families and cooperative housing societies. And greenfield land amalgamation, in what Amita was saying, and the large schemes, is going to be difficult. Now, it is only in my state, but in Mumbai it will be different. And so it
you
comes
say
from
it is something in Ahmedabad, but you learned it from Mumbai.
TPS. How about now we are claiming to
no,
be
I'm just saying.
I know, but you abandoned it and we are going gaga, doing at national
order.
Level.
At order.
We are doing national order. Level sort of promotion of this idea. But anyway, so this kind, and so whether private sector functions or not today in India is a larger macroeconomic question as well. And within that you look at housing, and that is where the current, and we don't know tomorrow, next year if you come, we may have another set of issues that we want to flag, because the policy regimes are changing very rapidly.
Yeah, you want to
Sort of looking for and didn't find, and I mean the other Indian speakers should pitch in as well, is the Cold War. Where is the history of the Cold War? Even in India, so much of the early housing development policy was basically in the context of the Cold War. I mean, for example, development of cities like Faridabad, etc., in the immediate aftermath of the partition. So on and so forth. So much of how the bank made aid, especially to the sector, was also somewhat strategic. I mean, so how does the strategic history sort of play in there? My question to Dashini and Amita, I mean, this is again something that I was hoping to see. I only know of this from my own city, which is Bangalore. How has successive policy regimes that you've talked out played out in terms of social segregation of space, right? In Bangalore, for example, I mean, I've been doing some work. It's very clear that new spaces that have been created in the last decade and a half are more segregated, caste, class, any which way you look at it, than they were in older parts of the country.
Do you
want to
add anything? Yeah, actually, I focus just on the World Bank, but I've written on this in a longer piece, and there actually I very explicitly engage with the World Bank enters this field in 1970s, but USAID was very much active in this much earlier on. And actually what you see is that the model that USAID had developed, in particular in Latin America, in particular because of the threat of communism, etc.,
was a model that was centrally organized around, on the one hand, home ownership, and on the other hand, finance. And it, the US government had set up all these schemes to subsidize finance providers, housing finance providers in Latin America. And so in a way, the World Bank picks up on a pre-existing kind of set of principles that it then continues to promote, that very much reflect the concerns of the US during the Cold War in terms of its fear for. So I think, yes, the origins of why the model took this particular form have got a very strong, if you want, roots in the Cold War and USAID practices, very much so.
To the question on the Cold War, not in housing, but generally in the finance sector. I can give the example of Ahmedabad, but I don't know what has happened in other cities. When we looked at the budgets of municipal budgets, Ahmedabad budgets, early 90s, it's period of where AMC went and borrowed from USAID.
Mm-hmm.
And we had this. And it's the time when housing and loan association crisis happens in the US. So yes, there is a direct impact of the changing global politics into what influences at local level. And so it was not the Washington consensus of the late, but it's post-90s that we see this. On the question of social segmentation or segregation, indeed, Indian cities are, and Ahmedabad is one where I've written a lot about it being segmented on religious lines. There's a complete segmentation, not in those Muslim areas. And it happens through both political processes, engineered riots that happen periodically, and the land market interests. They all get together. So they happen, I mean, yesterday also I was reading an article in newspaper on the where the diamond in Bombay, where do they live? They live in specific localities and don't allow anybody else to enter the camp, the compound. So there's a diamond tower, and the Palanpuris live in the same building. And that the earlier segmentation of cities on the even caste lines has not gone today in the Indian fabric. Now one was expected, so we have Jain Merchant Society, and Brahmakshatriya Society, I'm talking about Ahmedabad, Brahmakshatriya Society, etc. Srimari Society is about the subcaste within the Baniyas. And they, actually I have grown up in that, and everybody around was our subcaste people. Now, that remains, which gets imposed on this new policy things. Now, what would be the outcome of it? Ahmedabad Sabarmati Riverfront resettlement process. There was a sub-affidavit filed in the High Court because this case was being sorted out through PIL, and the case was ongoing, and another PIL as a part of it was filed saying that allow resettlement on religious lines, and so allow Muslims to be allocated in certain, together in one settlement, and Hindus to be allowed to be resettlement on Hindu sites where they are in, I mean 100% Hindus. Households, and the court, High Court allowed it. The lawyer who had filed PIL said that I had no choice because Muslims and Hindus, if they stay together, none of them feel safe, in spite of the politics that we know around communal riots. So that is happening, and we see this kind of even sub-segregation. So you have this whole notion of market and the state, and that's playing out. The subterranean Indian context of social segregation is also happening, and sometimes it gets enhanced when there is a state intervention for, let's say, resettlement.
And I think that has definitely impacted the housing policy in several cities in the country. And perhaps instituted also certain kind of regimes. So even while creating a Delhi development plan at a large level, there were always the exceptions to the plan which started getting created because of a contingent situation of an influx of refugees, whether it is in Delhi, Kolkata, Mumbai, the entire Ullasnagar and the collector colony settings. So one sees this narrative of so many segmented markets and exceptions being created right from there. The World Bank per se influence in the country, I think, was only in the 1980s as a direct intervention. But after that, within the entire housing sector, there has been very minimal influence. They've tried to kind of move toward the entire property rights regime, and which has proved to be like a gargantuan task, which I think is taking up its own kind of a labyrinthine space moving. So I don't see the World Bank being the most critical to the ways in which projects and Indian housing policy is moved, but the influence of ideas has definitely been there. Enabling landmarks to work, the 1997 report. If one begins to see the entire modeling of Indian housing policy, there is a lot which is taken from there. But at the same time, Indian housing policy, as I said, refuses to give up this entire control on land. So there's like a partial thing.
I think Soumen will have the last question.
Very briefly, this is in connection with what Darshini said about the NGO's intervention in Pune. What did the NGO do to make a difference? In view of the fact that housing is more like a private good and state does regulate the sector. Second observation is about the state. It was very clearly emerged out of the discussion that, you know, there are two levels of the state failure, to understand state failure. One is that, what I was referring to is that is an institutional economics framework. Principal agent problem, and state is doomed to fail, even in the best of the country. And second is what you referred to is the political economy. In fact, the real estate contribution to the underground economy just referred was considered to be one of the highest in India. Land is a very coveted asset. And that's a larger political economy approach. Third is about, you know, we are talking about market perfect, imperfect market, and perfect market to imperfect market. What I also could gather that, you know, market is being manipulated because the consumers are manipulatable. That's very different from what the neoliberals say. And the last observation is about this Elisa's presentation, the focus on the financing, and, you know, the refuse to revisit the earlier scheme. I think this, invoking neoliberalism again, the understanding is that the focus on loan is that will make the people more responsible. Responsibilization is the one of the other things. And that's why, even if there is a state failure, they're refusing to revisit. Because this is what they actually believe.
Observations, anyone wants to react, you may, otherwise I will just wrap up. And we can have this discussion over lunch, I guess. All right, so we had a very rich set of presentations. I continue to be delightfully confused, of course, because...
Converted to the confusion?
Yeah, no, I came here confused. I continue to be confused because I still am not, what I said in the beginning, I'm not clear on that exactly. What you mean, this group means by PPP, because you've got all these three, then you've got those six things that the government is talking about, quite different things from what you were discussing, but let that be. I want to just say a few things. Number one, I think land was very properly discussed in more than one of the main things, as one of the main issues underlying this whole thing. Even the political economy aside, and I know that this is all very complex, etc., etc., you brought in the complexity. I'm going to be naive and say some very simple things where we can marginally improve, taking the clue from what was said that, okay, we dealt this hand, now what do we do with it? So, you know, we need to have something like what Canada and Australia and others have, what are called as the town companies, which for the land commissions and land. We have an issue because constitutionally land is a state subject. We are now talking of the affordable housing within cities, and our cities are not empowered at all. That's another issue, problem that we have, but I'm not going to talk about the problem. So the marginal improvements we can have is to have a land commission so that we can at least manage the public lands properly. I mean, even without attributing conspiracies, intentions, motives and all that, today the capacity simply does not exist because I don't know. When I go to Mantrala and have discussions there, they simply have no clue about where their own land is and what is meant by the public land. It's only when some redevelopment authority goes there that some other arm of the government says, hey, but that's my land, and then they get into litigation. The maximum litigation that we have today is between different arms of the government, not the private and the public. It's between the public, intra-public. So that is one thing, and then you can think of monetization and all those other things, leveraging the whole value of land, etc., for doing social good, etc., that we could do. ALCRA was mentioned. ALCRA is a movement from dysfunction to dysfunction. The way it was formulated and the way it was repealed, and remember that it was repealed in the state of Maharashtra as an arm twisting exercise, because it was a prerequisite. But this links up with what the World Bank doesn't do. It was the World Bank that formulates now policies. The thing that Eliza mentioned, that it moved away from the sites and services, which was a project-based thing, to policy-based stuff. It simply refused to get into projects, etc., post the sites and services program, which worked well. Why the government didn't take it further, I don't know. But that's another discussion. The ALCRA land, when people genuinely thought, you know, that so much land supply would come, there was this problem that even I had thought that, okay, this would happen. Why did it not happen? I don't know, some of the younger people may not know, so I may just mention this. That the courts held that those that have gone into litigation now cannot be released, even if the law today because there was an argument which said that today there is no ALCRA, so let that land be released now into the market. They said no, the litigation refers to the law as it existed then, so it will continue. So all these lands continue to be locked up, whether ALCRA is there or not. So there was no dent on the supply of land at all on that. Brownfield, greenfield kind of stuff that you talked about, I think I want to bring in just flag my pet thing that these days concerns me, and that is you have to think about municipal, beyond municipal boundaries, and use a metropolitan lens if you ever want to do this. Again, this is a World Bank kind of solution put, and you will call it gentrification, put these guys there, get a mass public rapid transport, because here we don't talk of kilometers, but 5 minutes that you can reach your workplace. That is the kind of a thing that you could look at. Public agencies were mentioned that were not doing much, etc. Much harm was sought to be done. Well, the whole idea there, again, I'm not talking of conspiracies and all that. Genuinely, there were 100 MLAs who wrote a letter now saying that this is anti-poor people, etc. When we tried to argue against the equivalence principle in the section 33, whatever that we had, where people were talking about telling MHADA that in case we can't build houses which were to be handed over, which would have enhanced the housing stock in the affordable segment, they said we will pay you money. But the point of MHADA was not to raise liquidity or resources, it was to increase housing stock. But this is what was happening through that, and that is where NGOs come into the picture. That NGOs come into one way in which a civil society which can do this is to vehemently oppose these kinds of marginal changes in the DCRs and all those things that are happening. The other way in which NGOs can come into the picture, you talked about the Pune thing, is look at the paper by Makhija on this, what SBs, Sheila Patel and all these guys did here from Spark. and how they themselves had to become part builders in order to sort out the issue. But I think NGOs matter a great deal. You know, housing shortages was mentioned. You know, Darshini, you were a part of the group. You were not present perhaps, but when we were discussing this at the national level, we were at a point of time where our calculations showed there was no housing shortage in this state at the macro level. And the way we created housing shortage, we are a committee of trying to estimate what the housing shortage is. There is no housing shortage is what we are getting. Now, so what we did was, we said, okay, we redefined what is acceptable housing, and we defined it in such a way that we got whatever 18 million or whatever, which seemed to be a reasonable figure, and so on. I don't care here, I don't belong either to the government or to, now I have become a part of NGO, so it doesn't matter. So, urbanization policy, this is an old historical mindset that we have, you know, India lives in the villages, blah, 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 whatever. So now, but in the recent report that we have just signed 3 days ago for the government of Maharashtra, one of the strong recommendations is that we have to have an urbanization policy, so that it will be there. After we are 50, we are recognizing only 46.
They will
but
find new lands to be urbanized.
Yeah. So, go on, but just one final, slightly controversial thing. I have come to the conclusion, from my perspective, that when you talk of affordable housing as being, or housing as for the poor, in a situation where you have so much pent-up demand in the LIG and the middle-income thing, it will, in the context of current political economy, lead to elite capture. Antyodaya is not possible. Therefore, please don't try to do all these things for the really poor, etc. They will find their own ways of surviving. Thank you very much.
But a caveat to it that let them be. Don't evict them.
That's where it was coming.
Abhi,
eviction vagara is out of the mindset of the current government.
It's not. They will want to evict me also, and if you are an NGO, they will raid you. So,
I don't think that. Anyway, that we will continue this conversation over lunch, maybe.
Thank you
very much.
Yeah.